What this will teach you, if you are able to inculcate it into your casual imaginings, is, you know, that you are every man. That, you know, galleons set sail for America inside you every hour and a half. And Rome falls, pyramids are built, migrations take place. We are the microcosm. This was the alchemical ideal of the 16th century that was stomped out by the rise of Cartesian rationalism. You know, it's no coincidence that when Michael Meyer, the great prince of the Rosicrucian Enlightenment, was slaughtered in the streets of Prague in the winter of 1819 by invading Habsburg armies, that one among those invading Habsburg armies was the 21-year-old René Descartes. I like to imagine, actually, that Descartes was present at the slaying of Meyer, and that this was, unknown to each, a tremendous turning point in the history of human thought, because the alchemical ideal, which had been inherited from the Hermetic ideas, from Gnosticism, which then went back to the Orphic and Pythagorean strain, and from there back into the Middle East, to Egypt, to the Nabataeans, and so on. This was like a countervailing faith, a different idea, an idea of wholeness, an idea of the power of magical naming, the power of sympathy. It was, in fact, the old morphogenetic religion. And that was the last time we heard from it, 1619, in the streets of Prague. It's no coincidence that that year is generally taken to be the beginning of the 30 Years' War. And as you know, when the 30 Years' War ended, modern Europe existed. When the 30 Years' War began, it was late medieval times. I mean, that was the great, great turning point. Well, one more little point that I want to make, and that is what empowers this idea, if you care to inculcate it into your toolkit of images for looking at the world, is history. And I think our powerlessness generally derives from our ignorance of history. And it's like amnesia. If you don't know what happened, you don't know who you are. And the fact that we live in a society where everyone is amnesic does not excuse the situation. I mean, it's a bizarre kind of society where no one really is expected to know anything about anything earlier than 10 years before their own birth. And then it just sort of fades off. You know, there are the two Roosevelts, and you can't tell which came first. And it's a preposterous situation, because history, unlike science, is not an intellectual construct that is the privileged property of an intellectual elite. History is the data field of every man, of every person. History is the set of conclusions and evidentiary deposits of information that we can all then form a common consensus of. Very few people experience quarks or mu mesons or these sorts of things. But history, because it's about people who are more or less like ourselves, is something that we can cognize and draw into our world. And it's not, you know, if you recall the great nightmare visions of anti-utopias in the 20th century, which would have to be Brave New World and 1984, though one was a kind of pillhead, happy, plastic sex, no worry situation, and the other was a grinding fascist nightmare. What these two anti-utopias had in common was they had no history. Nobody was allowed to find out or even ask the question or even conceive that there was something important about how people did it 1,000 years, 2,000, 100 years ago. They lived in a bubble of mindless now. And this is, I think, a very unhealthy trend that we can see being pushed all around us, that vast populations are being invited to exist in a historyless bubble of consumeristic reinforcement of utterly trivial images that are all new, shiny, untainted by the past. I had a woman tell me that she never went to art galleries because old things depressed her. Most people live in a shrinking world of three networks and X number of cable channels, and that's it. And that is fatal. That is lying down to planetary death. That is direct injection into the cultural vein of the heroin that will lead to Armageddon. What we need to do is reconceptualize ourselves through, I think, notions like the Tao. Make fractals a thing for the people. Make the psychology of fractals, which allows one to wait through adversity with confidence and to anticipate the moment to act with confidence and then to so act, that this, if inculcated into our psychology, would replace the existential loser roles that we have unconsciously imbibed from Christianity, Freudianism, behaviorism, so forth and so on.